Hi, I'm Tony Northrup, and today I'm going to provide a free overview of the Nikon D810. It's kind of like a better version of your camera's manual, so let's get right into it. If you have a different camera, or if you have a friend who has a camera and you kind of want to share a similar tutorial for them, you can go to sdp.io/tutorials to see all of the different cameras that we've provided overviews like this. So please share that with your friends in the photography forums or other people you know who are trying to get into photography. We have a lot of the most popular cameras there and we're always adding more. Normally the first thing I do is I show people how to attach the lens and put in the memory card and such, but I figure if you dropped like $3,000 on a new Nikon, you probably got that part down. So I'll tell you what, let's just skip over that and we'll go right into just talking about the ports on it a little bit, the physical ports. Over here on the left side of the camera, you'll see three different rubber gaskets covering ports. The top one is for your headphones and a microphone. If you're recording video, I strongly suggest you use both of those. They're just standard 1/8 connectors. Plug in some headphones so you can hear the sound in case there's wind or something messing up your sound. And using any kind of external mic, especially like a lavalier mic, like a wireless mic, we use Sennheiser EW100G3s, will greatly improve the sound because this does have a mic built into it, but you will always get bad sound out of that. The second port down here, maybe my favorite port, a USB 3 port, and that's significant because other cameras have USB 2 ports that make it kind of slow for tethering. But you can connect this and run the latest version of Lightroom, and your camera can automatically copy pictures into Lightroom so that if you're shooting in a studio or somewhere where you don't mind having a cable hanging from your camera, you can move your RAW files really quickly and instantly see them and even make adjustments to them on the fly. The bottom port here is an HDMI port that's used for two things. One, you could hook it up and see the camera's display on a big TV, but more likely you'd use this if you're using this as a video recorder. You could hook up an external HDMI recorder there and record your video. If you're a serious video guy, you'll be like, oh, I know I need that. And if not, then you'll probably never ever have a need to use that HDMI port. There are also two other ports here on the front. This top port is, you should never use this. This is the PC sync port. It's a very outdated port, literally dating back to like 1910 or something. And you can use it to fire strobes, but it's terribly flaky and kind of comes loose all the time on every camera. It's not this camera's fault, it's just the port's fault. More likely you'll just be using the flash hot sync shoe up here to fire your strobes. And the lower port is for a wireless shutter trigger. Nikon makes a few different wireless shutter triggers, but me, I always use one of these. Just a cheapo wireless shutter trigger. They cost $15 to $20 usually. They have different brand names, like newer, or I don't even know what that is. Anyway, you can see the connector here goes right into there. It's great for just locking the shutter open, though it does have a built-in intervalometer that we'll describe in just a little bit. Now let's talk about the process of taking a picture. And again, I bet you've already got this worked out. It's really easy. By default, you can just have to press the shutter. The focusing system will kick in, lock on your subject. The focus points will light up, showing you that it's in focus, and then you depress it fully to take the picture. Pretty obvious. When you want to review a picture, just hit the play button here. And hopefully I have another picture that I've taken. Oh, look, there are some pictures. Chelsea and I during our live show. And now once you're reviewing a picture, you have a bunch of useful options. The magnification button here allows you to zoom in. This is really useful for checking critical focus. So you can zoom over here and see myself on the picture. In reviewing mode, Nikons also have a very useful feature which will detect faces and allow you to quickly zoom in on them. This particular picture, unfortunately, it only detected my face. As I zoom in, you'll see it draws a box around my face and a little thumbnail down here. But it's not picking up Chelsea's face because she's turned to the side. If it detected her face, I'd be able to use the dial, the front dial here, the secondary dial, to jump right to the faces, and that's terribly useful. That allows me to zoom right in on the face and make sure that the critical focus on the eyes is there. For a group shot, that's really important if you're taking a group portrait, because you can push the zoom button once and then just flip forward with the secondary dial, flip through every face in the group and make sure everybody's face is sharp, and then inevitably somebody like close their eyes or move their head or something, so you'll have to reshoot, but at least you know how to do it quickly, right? As you're reviewing photos, you can view different types of information by pushing up here on the directional pad. So I have it configured when I push up to show me a histogram and to show me the various shooting settings. So you can configure exactly what you see from the menu. So let's do that now. Hit the menu button, and on the top option here, the one with the little playback icon, go to playback display options and then scroll to the right. And here you'll see the different options that you can scroll through when you're reviewing pictures. So just for the sake of argument, I'll go ahead and select all of these different options. And then as we're reviewing a photo, I can scroll through them by pushing up. And that's the one you saw before. All right, so I screwed up. After you select these things, I'll go in and select all of them again. You now have to hit OK, or else it doesn't necessarily remember it. So that time, it actually got it. I'll go in and review the last pictures taken, and now I'll push up on the D-pad, and now I can scroll through all the different options. You can see I have an RGB histogram here, which isn't all that useful. This is showing peaking with blinkies. This light back here was overexposed, so it's demonstrating that. That is the default kind of display. That is the picture only. So if you don't mind pushing up a bunch of times, you can just select all the different checkboxes. For me, I don't particularly find the RGB histogram or the shooting data to be useful, but I do like to have the other three selected. So now let's talk about how to select and use aperture priority mode. Aperture priority mode is kind of my default, my go-to mode. It's the camera I leave the mode I leave the camera in almost all the time. If I'm shooting outdoor portraits or a wedding, probably in aperture priority mode. To select aperture priority mode and to select all the modes, you'll hold down the mode button here and then scroll the main dial here on the back. So I'll hold that down and scroll the main dial, see if you can see this, until it says A up here in the upper left corner. Now, I'll show you a trick. I'll hit the info button here so that the back display comes on. That makes it a little easier to see everything. As I hold down the mode dial, now you can see I can scroll through the different modes by using the main dial. When you're in aperture priority mode, the front dial here will control your aperture, and the camera will select your shutter speed as required to properly expose your picture. So right now it's at f4, which is the minimum for this lens. If I scroll to the right, I can select f5.6 or f8. And you can see the camera is also changing the shutter speed here just to give me the proper exposure. So if I go all the way to the right, it will select the smallest aperture, the highest f-stop number. Remember, high f-stop number, high background sharpness. Low f-stop number, low background sharpness. So go back down to the lowest f-stop number, which is where I'll do most of my shooting. For more information about how aperture and depth of field work, check chapter 4 of my book, Stunning Digital Photography. This is really just a guide on how to push the buttons on your camera. All the conceptual stuff, all the important stuff is covered in the book. Now go over shutter priority mode, which is the mode I'll use for shooting sports, shooting wildlife, or any time where freezing motion or allowing motion to be displayed in the picture is more important than controlling the depth of field. So, kind of showed you this already, but I'll hold down the mode button here and then move the dial on the back here until we get to S. That's shutter priority mode. And now, when I move that back dial, the back dial here will always control the shutter and the front dial will always control the aperture. Works the same way in manual mode, just makes life a little more consistent. I will scroll it to the left to use a slower shutter speed. You can see I can go all the way down to 30 seconds. Great for taking pictures of stars, for example. Or I can scroll all the way to the right up to 1/8000th of a second. And that's really great for freezing motion. Just like manual mode, just as easy. Hold down the mode button, scroll over to the M. And now both the front and back dials work just as they did in aperture priority mode and shutter priority mode. The back dial controls the shutter speed and the front dial controls the aperture. You'll notice that the camera, while it's giving you pretty complete control over the exposure on the back or in the viewfinder when you're looking through it, it's showing you a hint of what it thinks the proper exposure is using the exposure compensation dial. So right now, as I'm going slower and slower with my shutter speed, you can see this graph here is moving to the right, and that's the camera saying, hey, I think you're going to overexpose the picture by 3 stops, by 2 stops, by 1 stop. And when it's in the middle here, it's saying, I think you have the right exposure. This means underexposed when it slides over to the left here. Now, that's useful information, but at the same time, I don't know why you're in manual mode with a manually set ISO if you're relying on the camera's meter to tell you which way to go. You should probably just Instead, either use auto ISO or use aperture or shutter priority mode. Now, manual mode on this camera does allow you to use auto ISO, and that means you can auto expose pictures while having complete control over your aperture and shutter speed. So if you are thinking and choosing deliberately your shutter speed and aperture, that is a great mode to choose, manual mode and then auto ISO. Let's also talk about bulb mode. Bulb mode, a general term in photography, means that you can keep the shutter open as long as you want. 10 minutes, 30 minutes. It's more useful on film cameras than it is on digital cameras, but there are still reasons to go with longer exposures. Now, I don't know why the camera doesn't let you just select more than 30 seconds by default in shutter priority mode, but it does stop you at 30 seconds. But now I'll show you how to select bulb mode. So first, you have to make sure you're in manual mode. This won't work in shutter priority mode. And then I'll just click the shutter past 30 seconds over to bulb mode. Now, when I hold down the shutter button, that's the shutter opening. When I let go, it closes. Open, close, open. So I could do a fast shutter, but there'd be no point in that. I would just select it if it were going to be less than 30 seconds. Or I could sit here with my finger on the shutter for 10 minutes or 20 minutes and properly expose the shot in almost absolute darkness. For example, if I was taking a picture of the Aurora Borealis. But if you were to hold your finger on there, even if your camera's on a tripod, you're going to be shaking your camera, right? So that's probably not a realistic scenario. Instead, what you're going to do, if you do need to use bulb mode, is take this and put it in there, your remote timer. And once it's in bulb mode, I'll just turn this on and then I'll just lock the shutter open by pushing this up. You could turn off that awful beeping. But now it's going to stay open until I decide to come back. You can also just set a time on this, but sometimes I'll just set it and remind myself to check back in 5 minutes. So I'll shut that off and the shutter will close. So now you're basically all set for chapter 10 of Stunning Digital Photography, which covers night photography. Speaking of, I'll take a quick second to plug my books. A lot of people think that the secret to photography is understanding the camera, which buttons and dials to choose, which settings to choose, which lens to get. It's such a small part of photography. Most of it is more art than science. Composition, lighting, posing, expression, mood, storytelling. These are all some of the most important parts of photography, and I cover it in my book, Stunning Digital Photography, over there on your far left. If you do get into the gear, if you want help understanding what all the terms for lenses mean, I provide a great deal of information about bodies, lenses, flashes, studio lighting, camera, equipment, tripods, just about everything you can imagine in my photography buying guide. And once you get into post-processing, a really important part of photography, even little edits like cropping and changing the brightness of your picture can mean a lot. You should check out my Lightroom 5 book. Even if you don't edit pictures at all, Lightroom is a really great investment because it will help you organize your pictures, tag your pictures with names so you can quickly find them later and they're not completely lost. Hook it up to a GPS or use a GPS app on your phone. It'll even throw it on a map for you. You can get all these from sdp.io/store or just search for my name, Tony Northrup, on Amazon. And if you're unhappy with anything, just let me know and I'll refund your money, most definitely. Everything comes with a money back guarantee, no time limit or anything, just let me know. I'd also like to talk about the shutter modes. Now, you can control the shutter. So, for example, right now I have the S selected here, that's the shutter mode. And that means when I push the shutter button down, let's get out of bulb mode here, I'll move it up to 1/8000. When I push the shutter, it just takes one picture. Even if I hold the finger down, it's always just one picture. You also have continuous shooting modes. CL is continuous low, like slow, and CH is continuous high. So continuous low, it's about as fast as it gets. Continuous high gets quite a bit faster. So you can choose your speed. I usually just go to continuous high and leave it there all the time. I never want the, like, if I don't only want to take one picture, I'll just take my finger off the shutter. So I don't know what single mode is for, because pictures are cheap, and if you do accidentally take an extra picture, no big deal. So pretty much lock it right into continuous high. There are also really useful quiet modes, quiet and then quiet continuous, and I'll just use quiet continuous. This makes it quieter, right? So you can hear that. That's substantially quieter, and if you're shooting a wedding or funeral, if you're a photojournalist and you don't want to disturb things, if you're a wildlife photographer and you manage to get really close in, choose that quiet mode and you just won't disturb things as much. I find it terribly useful. It is a little bit slower and it takes just an extra beat after you push the shutter, But it's usually not a problem at all, but that's why I don't use it by default. This thing here that sort of looks like a clock is the timer mode. It sets a delayed timer, so as I take it, you'll see the yellow light here is blinking, and it's gonna just keep blinking until it actually takes a picture. Okay, that was on a 10-second delay. And that's for those times when you have the camera on a tripod and you have to like run around and put your arm around your family and have the group picture, but you want to include yourself in it. You can also set it to a shorter delay, which is useful for eliminating camera shake if you're pushing the shutter and you have the camera on a tripod. I'll show you how to change that delay in just a second. The last mode here is mirror up mode. And what that does is the first time I push the shutter, it moves the mirror up. You heard that, but it's not taking a picture. That's just the mirror. The next time I push the shutter, it actually takes the picture. Mirror up mode very slightly reduces the amount of vibration in the camera. And for the most part, I don't use mirror up mode. It's great, especially for macro photography. Anytime you want absolutely the best sharpness, you should go ahead and get the mirror up. But there's what I think a better way to use mirror up mode. I'll put this back in just continuous high for a second. I prefer just to use live view. Live view flips that mirror up so that the sensor gets a continuous video feed of the world. So with live view on, the mirror is out of the way already. So now when I take a picture, it doesn't have to move the mirror. It's kind of automatic mirror mode and it gives you an easier display. And usually if I'm taking my time and I have the camera on a tripod, I'd rather be using live view anyway. So now I'd like to talk about how to set the speed for the continuous low mode. So I showed you continuous low and turn off live view mode here. Here I think it's at 3 beats a second. I'll hit the menu button here and go into the custom settings, which is this third little pencil icon, and CL speed is under D2. So I'll go under shooting display and then D2. You can see you can set it at the full 6 frames a second. Or you can go down to 1 frame a second if you just wanted it to be a little bit slower. So maybe you have a reason that you're just taking too many pictures or not enough pictures and CH is too fast for you. You can just go ahead and change it here. Also talk about how to change the self timer. That's another option. I'll switch this back over to the little timer mode. And again, with the pencil settings here, let's go over to C3. This sets the self timer delay. Right now it's at 10 seconds. You can set it to 20 seconds if you need more time to run around and put your arm around your family, or 5 seconds, or if you just have the camera on a tripod and you want to eliminate camera shake from pushing the shutter, 2 seconds. So most of the time I will just keep this on 2 seconds because I use that more than the running around technique. You can also set the number of shots, which I find to be great, great for self portraits. So I will just increment this and have it take 9 full shots. Then I'll put it on the tripod and fire it. It'll blink for 2 seconds. And it's going to keep taking pictures. And you can just tell your family to smile for the entire length of those 9 pictures and then go back and pick the very best one. Because, you know, like your kid brother is going to be like making rabbit ears behind your head or something. Somebody's going to have a weird face at some point. One of those 9 shots will hopefully be good. You can also, under that same option, control the interval between the shots. So 0.5 seconds is pretty good. But I will also go with a longer interval, like 1 or 2 seconds, so that people get used to the rhythm after a couple of shots, and they'll kind of know to smile. But I find it more effective if you have a longer shutter speed. This repeating shot is also very useful when you're working on a tripod and worried about sharpness, because sometimes other things will disrupt the sharpness a little bit. Maybe you're taking a picture on a wooden boardwalk and somebody walking past will shake your tripod and your camera. If you have it set to take 9 shots, well, chances are good that one of them is going to be sharper than the other. So anytime I'm really, really obsessed with sharpness, I will use that self timer and have it repeat itself many times. So now let's talk about the different focusing modes. Just like the shutter has different modes, the focusing system has different modes. And by default, when you turn the camera on, it's going to be in single focusing mode, which when you have to press the shutter, the focusing system will find a subject, lock onto it, and then stop trying to focus. This gives you the chance to use a technique called focus recompose. Once it's locked in, you can keep holding the shutter button down and then recompose your shot, allowing you to move the subject off-center, even into a part of the frame where there are no focusing points, and that's useful. But the D810 happens to have a great focusing system with focus points distributed all across the frame, and also has such a great focusing system, continuous focusing system, that I just use continuous focusing all the time. Even for still subjects, I'll just lock on focus and take a couple of shots, moving my focus point where I want it. So let's talk about how to change those different focusing modes, and it's really, really straightforward. The quickest way to change focusing modes is to hold this button down in here. You see this little autofocus, manual focus switch? Of course, you'll need it in autofocus mode, but then hold this button down, and let's get that info display turned on. I'll hold that down, and then I can use the back dial here to switch between AFS and AFC. Those are your only two options. Now, while you're here, you can go ahead and change the focusing points by holding that down and scrolling this around. So, as I said, I generally always use AFC continuous focusing, where it will hunt for focus as long as you have that shutter button halfway held down. I did just kind of show you how to change the focusing points, and it's actually really straightforward. You don't have to do anything other than just move the directional pad here. That makes it very easy to change your focusing point. When you have single focusing mode, a single focus point selected, on this particular camera, I almost always use a single focus point. I don't let the camera decide where in the frame it's going to focus for me. If I'm taking a picture of a person, I'll pick a single focusing point and then select the focusing point right over the person's eye, their near eye, and focus on that. However, there are times when I'm shooting sports and it's too difficult to keep a single focusing point on a moving subject. Same goes for wildlife, especially flying birds with a telephoto lens. It's hard to keep a bird in the exact same spot on a really long lens. So you'll choose multiple focusing points, and that way, if the subject wanders from the left third to the right third of the frame, the camera can continue to track that subject. So I'll show you how to select multiple focusing points. Once again, we're going to hold this button down, and this time we're going to move the front dial up here. And now you can see it's going to choose all the focusing points. This is group focusing here, and 3D focusing, which is the best option for tracking a subject. With 3D focusing, you get to select a single focus point, which establishes the initial subject that you're focusing on. And then after you lock on focus with that single focusing point, if the subject moves to a different part of the frame, it can continue to track. To go to the next mode, again, I'll hold that button down and scroll over to D51. D51 is their dynamic focusing system that uses all 51 autofocus points. And I don't often use that. I'll use that if there is a bird flying against clear blue sky, because with blue sky, there are no distractions in the background. If a bird isn't flying in front of trees in the woods, for example, you're better off using a single focusing point. For things like sports, you're better off using a group. But for birds against a clear blue sky, I'll use the 3D tracking or the D51. Either will work pretty well. If you go on, a more accurate system is D21, which uses the strongest focusing points, which are kind of clustered around the middle. That means you can't use such an off-center composition unless you scroll it over to the right. So you can see it's like a bigger group, and you can kind of move it around, but it will ignore a subject who's outside of the frame there. And you can also drop down to D9, which is just a smaller group of focusing points for times when you can keep the subject within a smaller part of the frame. So choosing between all the focusing points, D21 or D9, or group focusing, is just a matter of deciding how accurately you can pinpoint a focusing point on the subject. Again, with a telephoto lens, you're probably going to need to use more focusing points because your hand will shake. Thus, your subject will be moving up and down throughout the frame. If it's a still subject and you can really hold the camera still, a single focusing point is going to always be the best way to go. Now let's talk about manual focusing with the D810. I'm in the habit of just switching the lens switch from autofocus to manual focus. That just disables autofocus. So most better quality lenses will allow you just to grab the focusing ring even when you're in autofocus mode. And if you're using back button focus, which I'll show you in a little bit, you never need to worry about switching between autofocus and manual focus. The D810 does have a dedicated switch here. This does the same thing as a switch on the lens. It just turns off manual focus. or turns off autofocus when you switch it over to the M. The difference is that this switch is always in the same place. And if you switch between different lenses, I know sometimes there's some hunting, and some lenses will have like four or five switches on the side. This one has two. This switch is always in the same place, and I never have to go look at the lens first. I can just reach it with my finger and switch it when I need to. But again, switching autofocus and manual focus is something you never think about once you switch to back button focus, which I'll describe a little bit later. The best way to manual focus is to switch on live view. Now, at this point, of course, you can just focus manually. I'll have to switch this to manual mode because it's trying to autofocus for me. But it's still not that accurate. If you really want it to be accurate, go to live view and then hit this magnification button and just zoom it in all the way. So first compose your picture and then do this until you get it just precisely in focus. Now I can see individual pixels and I'm sure that it's completely accurate. This is the best way to go for macro photography, for landscape photography, night photography. Anytime you have the camera on a tripod, that's the technique I'll use to be sure that I'm nailing the focus. It's not going to be useful for portrait, sports, wildlife, because obviously you can't take the time to do that. And that's too bad, because those are the times when focusing is really tough, because you are typically working with shallow depth of field and you have moving subjects. So this isn't a good camera for that kind of thing. Other cameras have features like focus peaking or automatic focus magnification, electronic viewfinders that help you manually focus. Modern DSLRs with optical viewfinders are very hard to manually focus, so I almost always prefer to use the autofocus system, not just because it's easier, but because it's more accurate. So kind of steer away from manual focus whenever you can. Now let's talk about the metering modes on the camera. And I'm just going to quickly show you where they are, because once you get into chapter 4 of Studying Digital Photography, you'll see that I don't find much value in other metering modes besides the default matrix metering mode. But I will show you how to change them. There's a whole button dedicated to it right over here. Just hold this button down and let's turn off live view mode and show the info display because it's easier to see. So with that held down, I can just move the back dial to change the metering mode. And this is the mode I'll use all the time, the matrix metering mode, which is like the evaluative metering mode. Looks at the entire scene, weighs the foreground and background, and then the camera makes its best guess at the proper exposure. This is spot metering. Spot metering will look at a very small part of the subject. Figure that you want that middle gray, right between the brightest white and the darkest black, and then base the entire exposure on that. And I cover this in detail in SDP, but the reason that doesn't work well is that sometimes it'll meter off the pale of my skin or the dark of my jacket, and because people move and cameras shake, it might move from one to the other and your exposure will just vary wildly. It's also not that useful because it's very easy to take a picture, review your exposure, and adjust your exposure. In fact, it's much easier than trying to use spot metering most of the time. In the film world, I use spot metering all the time. It was like the only accurate way to do things. So if you're in the habit of that, feel free. But for most of us, if you're learning digital photography now or if you've adapted to the digital ways, you can pretty much forget about spot metering. To quickly go over the other metering modes. The metering mode, which looks like spot weighted metering but has a little star, is very useful. It's highlight weighted metering. And what this will do is allow the camera to examine the scene and detect the brightest part of the scene. Then the camera will make sure that that part is not overexposed. This is particularly useful if you're shooting a band where they have bright light shining on them and you want to make sure the lights are never overexposed. You're shooting a play where there are spotlights on the people, or really any time where you're being deliberate about the metering and trying to make the most effective use of the entire histogram, really can improve image quality to ensure that no part of the frame is clipped. And if you underexpose something, you can often recover those shadows and get that detail back. If you overexpose something, beyond a couple of stops that you might be able to recover from the raw file, if you overexpose something, that data is probably lost forever. And so highlight weight metering is a great way to make sure that you never lose that data. It's my second favorite metering mode besides evaluated metering. There are times when I don't mind clipping. If I'm taking a picture with the sun included in it, the sun is going to be overexposed. And I don't want the camera trying to base the entire exposure on the sun. And in that case, evaluated metering is more useful than the highlight weighted metering. Just be aware that the highlight weighted metering is there for situations like indoor spotlit subjects, bands, plays, and such. We'll bring that up one more time, and I'll just show you one last metering mode, which is, there we go, center weighted metering. It's like a little dot with parentheses around it. In this mode, the camera will look at the middle of your scene and kind of base the entire exposure around that. I don't find it that useful. I found the evaluated metering more useful. Now I'll show you how to change the ISO. It's a very easy thing to do on the camera. There's a whole button dedicated to it right up here. It says ISO in big letters. So I'll turn the display on the back, hold down the ISO button, and then just scroll this back dial. You can see I can select ISO 100, which will give me very high quality images. Oh, ISO 64, give me even higher quality images. I love ISO 64, it's my default. I use it for everything when I have enough light. If it gets dark, I can crank it all the way up just by scrolling to the right here. You can see once you get above ISO 12,800, it changes the scheme. These are extended ISOs, which are not real ISOs. It's basically just underexposing an ISO 12,800 picture and then kind of cranking the brightness up in post. So feel free to use the lowest ISO you can whenever you can. If you want to let the camera decide for you, hold down the ISO button and then move the front dial, and that little ISO auto logo will appear. This means that even in manual mode, the camera will use its metering system to evaluate the scene and set the ISO for you. So one of my favorite ways to use the camera is in manual mode with auto ISO selected. That way I can take advantage of the metering system with exposure compensation if I need to, and allow the camera to choose the ISO. Of course, it's always going to choose the lowest ISO that will properly expose your picture. So you're always guaranteed getting the best results, assuming you've deliberately set the shutter speed to the slowest shutter speed and the aperture to the lowest f-stop number. Now let's talk about exposure compensation. Earlier I talked about why I didn't care that much about the metering modes, and that's because I always make good use of exposure compensation. And in the digital world, where I can easily review my exposure and look at histograms, I prefer to let the camera make the decision and then, when necessary, review the picture and adjust the exposure afterward. I just find it more reliable and quicker. To use exposure compensation, hold down the exposure compensation button there and then scroll the main dial. Show you that with the display on the back here. They scroll to the right, you can see now it's added one stop of exposure compensation. I can keep scrolling to the right again and it shows two stops of exposure compensation. This is going to change the way the camera exposes the picture to make the picture brighter or darker. So I'll take a picture of my cameraman Justin here. I'll drop it down to no stops of exposure compensation, just the camera's correctly metered picture, and take a picture. So there you can see the picture of Justin. Now let's add two stops of exposure compensation. I would do this if I thought, hey, that picture ended up way too dark. It turned out okay. But sometimes pictures are too dark. Maybe you're shooting in the snow, where the snow is going to trick the camera into thinking the scene is shouldn't be as bright as it should be. So with two stops of exposure compensation, you can see this picture much brighter than the previous picture. And if a picture turns out too bright, you guess it, I'm going to dial that negative exposure compensation in, show the display, hold down the plus minus button up here, and I'll just scroll it all the way to the left. Let's go all the way down to, oh, look how far we can go. Negative five stops of exposure compensation. Can even go off the little chart, take another picture. Look, Justin's almost completely gone. Whenever you're done taking pictures with exposure compensation, I suggest you hit that exposure compensation dial again and just bring it back up to zero. I'll show you in just a second how to make that happen automatically. Now, one of the great things about Nikon cameras in general is that you can use that exposure compensation even in manual mode. Canon cameras can be a little more difficult to do this, but you can see here I have auto ISO, which means I am allowing the camera to decide the proper exposure for me, but I can grab the exposure compensation and dial it in. That's really great for things like wildlife photography. Often with wildlife photography, you're shooting against a bright sky and it could be a dark bird, like say a bald eagle or an osprey. In those cases, you need to use auto exposure because the bird might be flying in shade or might be flying in direct sun. So you kind of want the camera to adapt automatically to changing lighting conditions. The sun might go behind a cloud or it might come out, but you do want to add a stop or two stops of exposure compensation to make sure that the bright sky doesn't cause the camera to entirely underexpose the scene. But you also want to be able to control your aperture to maybe shut it down a stop from wide open to get the sharpest pictures possible or to give you enough depth of field to get both wingtips in focus. And you also, of course, need to control the shutter speed. So you need to control the shutter speed, the aperture, and the exposure compensation. You can do that using manual mode, auto ISO, and that exposure compensation dial. Again, kind of an advantage over a lot of the Canon cameras, though some of the more recent Canon cameras support that too. Another advantage of the D810 is it will automatically reset the exposure compensation for you. So with other cameras, I would dial in exposure compensation and then go to take a picture 10 minutes later and forget I dialed it in. So I end up with a whole set of pictures that are underexposed or overexposed and often ruined. Man, if you're a wedding photographer, can't do that. They include a very useful option that I think should be turned on by default. Under the menus with the pencil setting there, the custom settings menu, go to B4 and switch it to auto reset from off. When you turn it on to auto reset, it does two things. Well, it automatically resets after a set period of time, but it also turns on easy exposure compensation, which means you don't have to hold down that button every time. It's not a big deal to hold it down, but if you're used to other cameras where you don't have to hold the second button down, it can be a bit of an inconvenience. So now, because I have easy exposure compensation on, I have the camera in aperture priority mode. Now I can just move that back dial to change the exposure compensation. I don't have to hold the plus minus button down, but you still can. So that's entirely up to you. Now let's talk about bracketing. You can use exposure compensation to underexpose or overexpose shots, and often you'll look at a scene and realize, oh, I need to underexpose it, and you'll take your picture. Sometimes, especially in landscape work, you might want to bracket shots, which means you'll take an underexposed shot, a properly exposed shot, and an overexposed shot. In that example, I took 3 photos, but you might take 5 photos or 7 photos. You might bracket at plus or minus 1 stop or 2 stops or 3 stops. There are lots of different options. Now, in the film days, you bracketed when you just didn't want to screw up the exposure, because there was no way to know until you got back to the lab and you were printing it. With digital, you can easily just review your histogram and make sure that you got the exposure right and then adjust the exposure compensation. So bracketing isn't as necessary as it used to be, but it does have a useful meaning in today's photography world, and that's for high dynamic range photography. With bracketing, you can easily take 3 shots that you can then combine later and either create an artistic HDR photo or use HDR techniques in order to reduce or virtually eliminate noise in shadow areas, because you'll have a shot that's essentially overexposed, giving you more detail and more light in the highlights. So this camera makes bracketing very easy to turn on because it has a button dedicated just to bracketing. So BKT here in the front, I'll hold that button down. You'll kind of get used to where it is. Let's display this on the back. I'll hold that down. And now both the front and back dials are useful for different things. I'll use the back dial to expand between 3 shots, 5 shots, and 7 shots. 3 shots is fine for most situations. If you're shooting directly into the sun with like deep shadows, if it's a really high contrast situation, I'll choose 5 shots. And there have been a few times when I needed 7 shots or even 9 shots, but for the most part, 5 shots is as high as I'll ever go. You'll use the front dial here to control the difference in exposure between the shots. So it shows it up here as 1.0. That means a 1 stop difference in each of the shots. I usually start at a 2 stop difference, because with a 1 stop difference, there's hardly a difference in the exposure. But with 2 stops, it's more noticeable and useful. So usually I'll do plus or minus 2 stop bracketing. You can go up to 3 stops too, but 2 stops is more useful. It's kind of the sweet spot for me. And then either 3 frames or 5 frames. After turning on bracketing, you'll have to take 3 or 5 shots, however many shots you're supposed to take. Then you want to be sure to turn bracketing off. Otherwise, the next time you go to pick up your camera, it'll be automatically adjusting the exposure for you in this very confusing way. It can be baffling. Anyway, once again, you'll just hold down that bracket button there. Hold it down. And then scroll this dial over to the left until it shows 0 frames. Then bracketing is turned off. Now let's talk about using the flash and flash exposure compensation. To turn the flash on, should you ever need it in a desperate situation. I don't like on-camera flash really. There's a button right here, right next to the flash, and it pops right up. And now when I go to take a picture, poor Justin, always the model, it fires the flash and illuminates your subject. And sure, you could use that in the dark, though usually with this camera, I'll prefer just to use a higher ISO and shoot with natural light. I hate the light. The on-camera flash. If you want to turn it off, by the way, just push it down. You can also use flash exposure compensation to reduce the amount of flash, and that can be useful for fill flash. So there's a flash button over here, and it's also got the little flash exposure compensation dial there. So this works just as well when you have an external flash, though sometimes I'll just push the buttons on the external flash. I'll hold that button down. I'll use the front dial here to change the flash exposure compensation. So let's say I want more flash for some reason, just for illustrative purposes. I'll crank it all the way up, take a picture of Justin. So now as we review those two shots, you can see this is that most recent shot. The flash is much brighter. Go back to the first shot and the flash is not nearly as bright. I will very rarely turn the flash up. What I do much more often is hold that flash button down and then drop the flash to, wrong dial, to negative 1.3 or negative 1.7 stops. This will kind of allow it to behave in the manner of fill flash, just adding a little light to the scene, filling in shadows on the face, adding a catch light to the eyes. So we'll take another picture like that. And as you can see, compared to the previous pictures, this one has much more flattering lighting. It's primarily relying on the ambient light in the room, but it's adding just a little flash, a little life to the eyes, making the color a little more natural. So fill flash actually can be useful. The onboard flash is also useful for controlling remote flashes optically, though I much prefer radio flash systems. I have a couple of recommendations at the end of this. Now we'll talk about white balance. See, your eyes kind of automatically adjust white balance so that when you're inside under incandescent lights, they look white. Then when you go outside in the sunlight, it still looks white. And it looks the same. If you were to take a book outside, it would look white. And if you read it inside, you wouldn't be like, why is it so, why are the pages yellow now? But incandescent lights, fluorescent lights, the street lights outside, they all have very slightly different colors. This is called the white balance or the color balance or the color temperature. And your camera, like your brain, tries to automatically adjust to the different white balances. You can manually set a white balance if necessary, but I recommend always using white balance and shooting raw. And that's something we'll discuss in just a little bit. So to manually change your white balance, hold down the white balance button here. And then scroll with the back button through the different options. So you can see I'm on auto white balance here. The light bulb, incandescent lights, you have fluorescent lights, sunlight, flash white balance, cloudy days. So they have basically all the different white balances, and that's how you select it. I want you to know how to do that. But I use auto white balance because when you shoot raw, you can change the white balance in post-processing, and there's absolutely no loss of data without any loss of quality at all. And that's just my preferred workflow. I generally prefer to get things right in the camera, but at the same time, I don't want to waste too much time thinking about little details that won't matter much. I'd rather think about bigger things like composition, framing, motion, other camera settings. So now let's go ahead and talk about the diopter. The diopter is mostly for people who wear glasses. It can allow you to see properly when you hold the camera up to your eye with your glasses off. So you can lift your glasses up and lift it up. That way you can just hold the camera to your face naturally, and it's like building your glasses into the camera. But it's important for everybody to understand the diopter because sometimes the diopter gets adjusted accidentally, and then you look through your camera and everything's blurry and you can't figure out why. This will save you a lot of trouble just knowing where this is. The diopter's right here. What you want to do is pull the diopter out. It's locked, so it shouldn't get accidentally hit very often. Then look through the viewfinder, just autofocus on something, and kind of look at the numbers at the bottom as well as the scene, and just adjust it until it's as sharp as it can be, and then just push it back in. It's kind of like when you're at the eye doctor. It's better here or better here. Just click through until everything's as sharp as it can be. You might not choose to use the diopter if you have multiple different photographers using it, because it's just baffling to people when they pick it up and the diopter is wrong and everything's out of focus. Now let's talk about using Live View. Live View, we discussed it a little bit. Terribly useful. Make sure the switch is on the camera mode, then hit the LV button. And it clicks right on. It's pretty obvious. It's just showing a constant video feed. You can change the focusing point using the directional pad, just as you always do. And autofocus is going to be terrible in live view. It's not nearly as good as when you're looking through the viewfinder, because it has to use a contrast-based focusing system rather than the sophisticated phase detection system. You don't have to know what that means. Just know that focusing with the live view, with the viewfinder, is way better, way, way, way better than with the viewfinder. You can view different information on the screen by just hitting the info button here. So one useful thing is that virtual horizon. You can see there, helps me level my picture. You can also magnify this scene as I showed you earlier. This is terribly useful for landscape photos where you want to manually and precisely focus, or macro photography would be the only mode I would use for macro photography. There's not much more to live view. There's no touchscreen or anything, but that's basically how you get it turned on. Very closely related mode is video. So I'll just take the switch and go down to the video camera here. You can see it always uses live view, even if you didn't have it on before, and crops it down to 16:9 by default. Once again, I can hit the info button here to display different modes. And when I'm ready to start recording, there's a record button right next to the shutter button. So, well, first I'll focus that. This is not going to be a very exciting video, but at least we can have it in focus. So I'll hit that record button, and now it's recording. There are a few different settings you can choose for video. For example, the resolution and the frame rate. I'll stop the recording. You could pretty much load the video directly onto Facebook if you wanted to, but most of the time you'll want to edit it with something like Movie Maker or Premiere Pro or Elements. There are a lot of different movie editing apps. To change your video settings, I'll go over here, hit the menu button, then dig in. The very last setting on the shooting menu, the little camera, go to the right here. All the video settings are buried under here. They should have given it its own menu, but they didn't. The top one here allows you to choose the resolution and the frame rate. My favorite is the top one, 1080p, 60 frames a second. Almost everything you see is at 24 frames a second for movies, or 30 frames a second for like TV and videos. But 60 frames a second, which you can publish on YouTube or watch on your computer, makes a big difference. Everything is so smooth. It feels like lifelike, almost 3D. Really makes a difference. So choose 60 frames a second whenever you can. You also have the option of normal quality or high quality. High quality files will take up more space, but you won't see as many compression artifacts. So obviously that's the better choice, as long as you have plenty of storage space. You can control the microphone sensitivity, and you can see it's responding to my voice here. Normally you'll want this at auto sensitivity, unless you hook up a microphone, in which case you'll definitely want to use manual sensitivity. The frequency response kind of controls how much sound it records. So if you select vocal range here, it'll basically just help you weed out background sounds. If you were just recording somebody narrating something, just wanted to record voice, but generally you'll just want it on the wide range. Wind noise reduction, pretty obvious. If they think there might be wind, you can go ahead and turn that on. Only useful when you're using the on-camera mic. The destination controls which of the two memory card slots it's going to record to. See, I don't have an SD card connected. I have a CF card, and it will tell you the maximum recording time, which is always going to be, it's never going to be more than 30 minutes. Because of European taxation laws, hardware manufacturers limit how long you can record with these cameras, so you can only record up to 30 seconds. If you need to record for longer, guess what? You have to go back to your camera and hit that record button again. If you want something different, you can either get a real video camera or go for a Panasonic camera like a GH4. Those have unlimited recording times. So we'll back up a little bit, and the last option down here is movie ISO sensitivity settings. And so here you can just basically control the ISO and what it's going to choose for auto ISO. Well, I prefer using auto ISO for stills. I'll almost always manually set the ISO for video because it's more disturbing to see the exposure suddenly change when you're not expecting it. Maybe somebody in a black jacket walks in front of your camera, the camera's auto exposure system would immediately like raise the ISO and make the whole scene really bright. Then when they walked away, it would make the whole scene really dark. So manual mode and manual ISO is almost the right choice, almost always the right choice when recording video. Now let's talk about formatting your memory card. You will eventually fill up your memory card, and to clear it off, the easiest way to do that is just to format the card. Of course, you want to make sure you have all your pictures on your computer and backed up somewhere, two copies of everything. You don't want to lose it, right? But then when you're ready to format it, go down to the wrench icon here. It's the very top menu setting. Format memory card. You can pick between the two slots. Select it and format it. I have some awesome pictures of Justin on there, though, so I don't want to delete that just yet. I showed you the virtual horizon in live view, but you can also view it through the viewfinder. Just hit the function button, which is right over here, right next to the lens. Just push the button once. You don't have to hold it down. And then when you're looking through the viewfinder, you'll see the little gauges on the bottom and the right side show you how far off center you've twisted or tilted your camera. Now let's go through a couple of custom settings. The DA10 actually doesn't have the beep on by default, but if you want to turn it on, I'll show you how to turn it off. I hate the beep, so I make a habit of telling everybody where it is. It's under the custom settings menu, the little pencil icon, and it's D4. So we'll scroll down to D4. No, D1. It's D1. So beep volume should be off because beeps are annoying. And then if you, for some reason, wanted to turn it on, like if you hate yourself and the people around you, you could then control the pitch. That's how you turn the beep off. Now I'll show you how to configure your camera to shoot RAW. This is the most important setting. The first thing that I will always change. By default, your camera will shoot JPEG pictures, which are heavily compressed, and a bunch of information is clipped, like all the super brightest stuff and all the deep shadows. By shooting RAW, you capture all the data that the sensor captured. That means it's going to be a bigger file, bigger pictures that take up more space on your memory card, more space on your disk. It takes more computing power to process them. So everything will slow down a little bit. But your picture quality can actually go up much, much higher. And if you pick the DA10 with the 36 megapixels and the world record-breaking dynamic range, you probably care about image quality, right? So to turn on RAW, it's really easy. There's a quality button right up here on the top. I'll hold that down, and then you can see I can just scroll the back dial here until I just see RAW. Now it gives you the option to shoot TIFFs for some reason. No, you don't want that. Or to shoot JPEGs. Just select RAW and you should be good to go. When it comes to processing your RAW pictures, I personally prefer Adobe Lightroom. Everybody I know uses Adobe Lightroom. But you can also use the free Picasa app. Now, you can get Adobe Lightroom with Photoshop for $9.99 a month. So you shouldn't cheap out. It's definitely a worthwhile investment, but Google Picasa is a free app that will process your RAW files and do a really good job at it. Now let's talk about how to assign some of the other function buttons, including that FN button up here. By default, that turns on the virtual horizon, but you can change it to be just about anything you want. So just hit the I button here, and in the lower right corner here, you see the option to assign the FN button. You could do this through the menus too, but this is an easy way to do it. So I'll select that, and now I can choose from a couple of different things. I can have it respond when I push it by selecting from the press menu and then select from all these different options. Maybe you find one of these useful. Or you can have it alter the effect of the command dials. So you would hold it down like you do the ISO button and then move a dial. So scroll to the right here and you'll see all the different options you can do. This camera has so many buttons on it, I don't feel the need to assign the function button to something different. I like the virtual horizon, so I just leave it at the default. Now I'll talk about how to assign the bracket button. It's basically the same thing. If you don't use bracketing, you can scroll over here to the assign bracket button after pushing the I button here. Bottom middle row, select that, and you can see you can choose either bracketing, multiple exposure, or HDR photos. HDR will only work if you're shooting JPEG, so if you have a RAW workflow, you're going to want to shoot bracketing anyway and then process the HDR later. But multiple exposures are a pretty cool trick. I think also only works for JPEG. So just another way you can assign that. Believe it or not, you can also reassign the record button for when you're taking still photos, because obviously it doesn't have any purpose when you're taking stills. And if you're not a videos guy, you probably never use it. The record button is an extremely convenient place, so you can assign it a more useful job. To reassign the record button, hit the menu button here, go to the custom settings menu, and then go down to Controls F. Then it's down here at F13, Assign Movie Record Button. It's only going to reassign it when you have it in stills mode. So your only option here is to alter the effect of the command dial. So you have to hold it down and then work the command dials. You can see you can change it to adjust the ISO, the white balance, to change the image area, like for cropping, so you're not capturing the entire sensor, but cropping it down a little bit by default, or changing the shutter speed and aperture lock. So there's already a button for white balance and ISO, but it might not be as convenient for you. Maybe you don't want to have to take your second hand away. You can do it all one-handed if you reassign the record button, a useful function. Now let's talk about my favorite feature on any camera, back button focus. I assign RAW, and then I turn off the beep, then I assign RAW, and then I turn on back button focus as the first three things I do on any camera. What back button focus does is, it means you never have to switch to manual focus again. You will never accidentally refocus. For example, when you're taking night photography pictures, you can use focus recompose or continuous focusing without changing camera modes, which is great for sports. Chapter 4 of Standing Digital Photography has a detailed description of back button focus and why you want to use it, along with a video. I'm just going to show you how to turn it on. So to turn it on, all you really need to do is to decouple focusing from the shutter button there and allow the AF on button here to activate focusing instead. To select back button focus, it's really easy. Select your custom settings button, go to A autofocus, and then go to A4, AF activation. Change it from shutter / AF on to AF on only. And now, autofocusing will only happen when you press the AF on button here. Trust me, it's awkward at first to have to use separate buttons for focusing and taking pictures, but in the long run, it'll save you so much time and frustration. It's definitely worth it. Now let's talk about how to turn on the interval timer. One of my favorite things about this camera and other Nikons is they have an interval timer built in, so they will continuously take pictures forever on whatever kind of schedule you want, which means you often don't need a remote shutter trigger. So I hit the menu button here, and on the shooting menu, the little camera, I'll scroll down to like the third page below multiple exposures is interval timer shooting. So I'll select that, and first I'll go into the little start options. Will allow you to choose now or to start later, but usually you'll just start now. Now you'll set the interval. So I'll go back in and select it, select the interval. And so now you can control how long it waits between shots. So if you want to take a shot every 1 hour, 1 minute, and 10 seconds, that's what you would select. So I'll click OK. See, it says OK down there. The OK button is down here. And now we can control how many intervals to execute and how many shots per interval. So if you wanted to take 9 shots every interval, you would set that to 9. And then you would use this to control how many times it would execute that same interval, if that makes sense. Most of the time, if you just want to take continuous shots up to 9 shots, you'll just select 9 there. And if you just want to take one shot per interval, which is the most common thing, you'll just select 1 there. So hit OK to return back. Exposure smoothing is something you will turn on if you're doing a time lapse, if you're going to blend the photos together into a nice video, something I demonstrate in the Lightroom book. It's pretty easy to do. Otherwise, you will just leave it off and it will either use the auto exposure that settings that it detects, or not change the settings at all if you have it set to manual mode with manual ISO. Exposure smoothing, instead of making a jump of say a third or half a stop, it will make smaller increments so you won't see that jump of every third stop of exposure. When you're ready, scroll up and click start. It warns you, and then it begins taking pictures. I said to take pictures every hour or something, so it's going to take a while. I'll just turn the camera off to disable the timer. I just want to quickly show you where the HDR feature is, and I'll warn you that you can't use HDR if you are have the camera set to RAW. So the first thing you'll want to do if you want to do HDR is hit that quality button and go over to JPEG. You have to be using JPEG. Now, in the menu system here, on the shooting menu, the last item on the second page is HDR. Just scroll over and set this to on. Usually series is what you'll want to do. It'll take multiple pictures and then automatically blend them together. And you can choose the exposure differential, just like we discussed in the bracketing section, and choose whether you want smoothing. It's an artistic effect and how it applies it to the final JPEG. I don't ever recommend using this HDR feature. It's kind of more useful in the Canons, where it will take raw photos and allow you to blend them later manually if you want. If I'm shooting HDR and I want the results to be good, I will instead shoot raw, bracket the shot, and process it with software later. So before I forget, you should do this too. I'm going to set it back to raw. I have to turn HDR off. Now I can go in and set it back to raw. Now let's talk about cleaning the sensor. The camera will automatically try to shake dust off. It's not perfect, so you might have to manually go in and clean the sensor occasionally too. By default, it will try to clean the sensor when you turn it on or off. I'll show you how to control that. Hit the menu button. On the setup menu, the little wrench icon there, go down to Clean Image Sensor on the first page. Scroll to the right. You can choose to either clean it right now or to clean it startup and shutdown. Scrolling over here allows you to turn cleaning off, but I love cleaning. I'm so glad that it has that built in. Cleaning now, it's just shaking the sensor around a little bit. It's working on it now. If this doesn't work, if you see dust, little spots in the sky or areas of even color, then you'll have to go in and manually clean it. So what you'll want to do then is select the lock mirror up for cleaning option. When you take the lens off, that will move the mirror out and expose the sensor, which it's normally hidden behind the mirror. Then you can use a brush, as I describe in Chapter 5 of Stunning Digital Photography, to clean it up. Notice that lock mirror up for cleaning is disabled for me right now. That's because my battery is at 3 bars, and I want you to have a full battery because it just doesn't want the battery to die during the cleaning process. The Nikon does have an option for AF fine tune, and I'll show you how to do that, but then I'll tell you that you should probably almost never use it. Also, in Chapter 5 of SDPA, describe a very rigorous process for testing your lens's focus. But I want to warn you about this because I see so many highly technical people decide, perhaps incorrectly, that their lens has a focusing problem and then try to fix it with AF fine tune. Indeed, the lens didn't have a focusing problem to begin with. It's just within the margin of error. Focusing systems are never perfect. You'll just miss focus sometimes, especially when you're working with fast lenses that have low f-stop numbers like f1.8 or f2.8. They have a shallow depth of field, and you suddenly become aware that the focusing system isn't perfect. They will just occasionally miss, or maybe they'll even miss most of the time with moving subjects. It's never quite that precise, but it's a limitation of the technology, not an error with the lens. So anyway, these technical people go in and use the AF fine tune, adjust it when there wasn't an initial problem, but now there is a problem because the AF fine tune system is adjusting the focus of the lens that didn't initially have a problem. So they now introduce a problem and they get into this terrible cycle of trying to adjust it and trying to fix it, when really they should just be taking more pictures and continuously refocusing and maybe using their focusing system differently. Describe much of that in chapters 4 and 5. If for some reason, after all that warning, you do want to change the AF, you want to try out the AF fine tuning, I'll show you where it is. Under the setup menu, the little wrench icon there on the third page, right at the top, AF fine tune. And so now you can go in and tune AF fine tune on and adjust the value. So you can see that this is going to be specific to this lens. So I can make it focus forward or back. And you can also view the different saved values that you have for different lenses. So it's basically different for every single lens. Again, I don't necessarily suggest doing that, but that's how you do it if you decide that you want to do that. I also want to show you how to use the menu banks just real quickly. You can have different groups of settings. For example, you might have a group of settings for landscape photography or wildlife photography. When you select the shooting menu or the custom settings menu, the first option there says shooting menu bank or custom settings bank. Here it's set to A for shooting menu. And you can see I have a custom setting menu of B selected here. So select either of these and you can choose from 4 different shooting menu banks. If you want to rename it, scroll to the right and, for example, you could call this landscape. And then click OK to save that. Now, unlike some other cameras, you cannot lock a group of settings. If you go in later and forget that you're in landscape mode and you go and make a change, it will save that change automatically. So you can't lock them, but they can still be useful. And I wanted you to know how you could save different groups of settings for different shooting styles. You can also save your settings to a particular memory card. You can use this as a kind of a more effective way to restore your settings every single time. You could have a separate memory card for landscapes or wildlife or portraits, and then load those settings in as soon as you get that particular memory card loaded. Show you how to load and save your settings. Hit the menu button here, and then on the second page of the setup menu is Save Load Settings. So I'll select that, and you can see I can either save the settings to the memory card or load the settings. Now you can't have multiple different settings saved to the memory card. You just save it, and then you load it. just whatever happens to be on the memory card. So that's why I say it's bound to that particular memory card. Just wanted to show you where it was. Now let's talk about how to choose a memory card slot, because this does have two different memory cards. There might be times when you want to record to the CF card or the SD card, or to mirror images between both so you have an automatic backup, or to fill one up and then default back to the other one when you start to run out of space. I like to use a really fast CF card and then put a big, slow, cheap SD card in there just as a backup, just in case I fill up, because it's better than nothing. The CF card is always going to be faster though. So even if you get a fast SD card, they're never as fast as the faster CF card. So make the CF card your primary and the SD card your backup. To select the different cards that you want to use, go ahead and enter in the menu system again. And on the shooting menu, on the first page here, you can see primary slot selection and secondary slot selection. And so those two are going to allow you to control which slot you're writing to. Here you can just select the SD card slot or the CF card slot. And the secondary slot function describes what's going to happen with the other one. So you can see you can record RAWs to your fast CF card and JPEGs to your secondary card, so that if your CF card does fail, and does happen, you'll be able to fall back to JPEGs, which are better than nothing. If you write RAW to both cards and your SD card is slower, then that could slow down the entire shooting process, causing the camera to buffer and slow down. So that can kind of give you that backup without slowing things down too much. If you don't need backups, I haven't had too many cards fail, but it does happen, go to overflow. So if I'm shooting for myself, I'll do overflow. If I'm shooting a wedding, I'm doing backup, either with RAW files or with JPEG files. Another feature that's useful for kind of professional scenarios is the control over file naming and folder structures. This happens if you have multiple shoots in a single day and you kind of want to organize your photos so that when you get back and you unload all the pictures onto your computer, they're named something logically. It's also useful if you're shooting with multiple different cameras and multiple shoots. It can be very difficult to kind of coordinate those. Anyway, if you need that level of organization, you might not, but if you need that level of organization, this is useful. Under the shooting menu again, you'll see two different useful items, storage folder and file naming. Storage folder, of course, is the folder that's written on the disk, on the memory card. And one of the most useful things you can do is take your memory card, put it in your computer, and create a bunch of different logically named folders. If you have a set of five shoots that day, you could say the Chelsea shoot, the Madeline shoot, the Justin shoot. And now you can quickly select the folder from the list. I only have one folder listed, but scroll through them and pick them. That way you don't have to try to type things out using the stupid little keypad. Or you can name your folders by using the select folder by number function here. Obviously you would want to jot down what each different number meant, but if you needed to organize your photos so you could find them later, that's a really useful way to do it, combined with some note taking. I also want to show you the different crop modes. By default, the D810 will use the entire 36 megapixel sensor, but that makes really big files. And if you're shooting sports or wildlife where you need to be cropping in post anyway, you can create smaller files that buffer, that take up less space in the buffer and allow you to shoot faster. Also fill up your card a little bit slower. With a D810 and a crop picture, you can also use a higher frame rate. So you jump up to like 6 or 7 frames a second, 7 frames a second if you have a battery pack on there. I'll just show you how to select the crop mode. The easiest way to change the crop mode is to push the I button here to bring up the shortcut menus, and then select assign FN button. What we'll do is we'll reprogram the FN button to allow us to change to a crop mode. So we'll select press and command L. So you'll be holding it down, and then we'll change this to choose image area. And so now you can see it gives you the option of FX mode, which is the full image, the full sensor, 1.2x crop, which uses a little bit, crops off the edges of it, gets you a little closer to the subject, but doesn't capture as much detail. DX crop mode, which has a 1.5x crop or a different shape sensor. Usually you'll be flipping between those. I never use 5x4, so I'll turn off that checkbox. Now I'll click OK. I can now hold down, let's turn on the info display here, hold this FN button down and use the command dial here to change between the different modes. So you can see it here. Now it's in DX mode, full frame mode, or 1.2x mode. Remember to switch it back to FX mode when you're done with your crop shooting. Now let's talk about how to use My Menu. I've been navigating the menu systems a lot today, and it can be really hard to remember exactly where all these things are. But you tend to go back to the same 5 or 10 menus. So what I like to do is to create a custom menu that allows me to use just those settings and not have to navigate through the entire thing. So open up my menu, and under the last item here, I'll select Add Items, and now I can select from the 5 different menus. So let's say under the Playback menu, you like to be able to hide your images. I'll just select that by clicking OK. And now I can choose, if I have multiple items, I can choose where I want that menu item to be. So I'll kind of just select it and then I'll click OK. Now when I go into my menu, you can see I have 3 items here. Hide image, clean image sensor, and then other items like adding or removing items from my menu, changing the order using rank items. My menu just allows you to quickly find frequently accessed settings that you haven't assigned to a function button. Now let's talk about which lenses and flashes you should buy for your new D810, because I have some non-obvious suggestions. Most people just immediately go for the Nikon versions, but there are some third-party suggestions that are much better values. And before I make these suggestions, I'm going to say I'm not sponsored by any hardware or lens, any camera lens manufacturer. We've never received free gear or payment, so I'm not beholden to anybody. These suggestions are just what I prefer, what I think are the best values. The number one lens I use is the lens I've had here the whole time, the Sigma 24-105. Paid for it out of pocket. Again, I said no free gear. It's vastly better than the Nikon 24-120 that so many people use. Even at 120 millimeters, you'll get more sharpness out of zooming to 105 millimeters and then cropping it. It's a much better lens, and it's even better built. I just love these Sigma art lenses. You can get it right from sdp.io/s105. And if you get it from that link, we get a few bucks, so help support us. I also suggest everybody get the Nifty 50, the fantastic plastic, the 50mm f1.8. Actually, you get the D or the G. The G is a little bit newer of a lens, but I prefer the 50mm f1.8D. I just put the wrong link up. It has an aperture ring on it, looks really nice and works really well. And because the D810 has a focusing motor in it, you don't need the G. This is an AFS lens, which has a focusing motor and thus allows it to work with cameras like the D3300 or the D5500. But you have a D810 with a focusing motor, so you can use all those old lenses. Instead of the Nikon 70-200, which I have here, I tell most people to get the Tamron version. The Tamron version is, it's about as sharp. Maybe it's a hair sharper. It has awesome image quality. The focusing distance and the focus breathing are the same. So it's basically an identical lens. It's not quite as heavy or as sturdy or as well built as the Nikon. So if that's important to you, if you're going to be beating your lens up, go ahead and get the Nikon. If you're a pro wedding photographer, go ahead and get the Nikon. But for most people who want to take pictures of their family, occasional pictures of their friends, pictures of their kids' soccer games, the Tamron version is a better value and will save you, you know, 500, 700 bucks. Get these used too, because the used Tamron and Sigma lenses don't hold their value as well as the name brand Nikon lenses do. So the used deals are awesome deals. And if you're into astrophotography, if you want to take pictures of stars, Nikon has a very expensive or some very expensive prime and zoom lenses. But this Rokinon 24mm lens is manual focus, has better image quality for stars, no coma. If you're into astrophotography, you'll know what that means. And it's only 550 bucks. You'll be paying like $1,200 to $1,800 for something similar from Nikon. It's a prime lens, but it's fast, beautiful, works just great, and it feels great too, really well built. For flashes, Nikon has a wide variety of flashes that are all overpriced in my opinion. I don't suggest them. If you want just an on-camera flash, has on-camera things that you need like TTL, great for snapshots, portraits, weddings, whatever, I recommend the Yongno YN568EX. Get the original, not the Mark II. The Mark II is for Canon bodies only, but the original is just fine and only 125 bucks. I think the Nikon versions are like 450 bucks. So there, I just save you 350 bucks. Like, send me a thanks or something. Maybe buy a book. Another flash, if you want to go off camera, if you want to get into multi-flash setups, I recommend the Yongno YN564. Just the newest version of it. It works with the YN560TX transmitter here, so you can control 3 different groups of flashes from your camera. Now, it's not a replacement for studio lights. It's for location lighting. If you're interested in studio lighting, I would recommend something different like an Alien Bees system, which I use. Check my photography buying guide. It has an entire chapter on studio lighting and a chapter on flashes if you want more suggestions. The first tripod I recommend everybody get is a great tripod from a brand you might not know, Dolica GX600B200. Very versatile travel tripod. And in the end, you might end up getting a heavier, more serious tripod, but you'll still come back to this because it's just a great lightweight tripod that's good for a hike or for throwing in your suitcase. So that about wraps it up. If you have any other questions, feel free to add a comment. And I encourage you to subscribe to see new free videos from us, including reviews about Nikon gear and detailed photography how-tos that are completely free. If you have $9.99, which you might, since I know you bought a $3,000 camera, check out my photography books, which will teach you important techniques. The Lightroom book will teach you post-processing, organizing your photos, make your pictures look much, much better. The photography buying guide teach you all about flashes, lenses, camera gear, help you navigate, and can save you thousands of dollars. Help you get some used gear instead of buying new gear. It's what I do all the time. Or my book, Stunning Digital Photography, the world's number one photography book. Comes with 9 hours of video. All of these come with tons of video. So even if you're not a book person, you can just watch the videos. And if you're unhappy about any of them, just drop me a note and I'll refund your money. Again, subscribe, share it with your friends. If you want to see other tutorials, go to sdp.io/tutorials. Give me a like while you're at it. Thanks.